The standardization is actually to support the government's effort and ambitious initiative to try and convert as many vehicles to electric as possible. To be able to say something like that, what is said in that report, we have a context. Of course, one is a per capita rising income, which you can afford to, more people can buy vehicles, electric vehicles are possible. And then this millennial advantage, the demographic dividend, I'm sure all of you have heard about it. India has the largest young people's population. The population peaks. So the advantage China had at one point of time was that they had a lot of young people, but they're passed. Now they're all 50 or so, like us, you know. But India is having the largest amount of, largest number of young people. So that explains partly our mobile growth and things like that. So that we can take advantage of that. It is necessary also. So then the context is also placed by the government's major thrust, not just this government, the earlier one as well. A lot of these basic structures, but this is a little bit more focused. Declarations are there about infrastructure development, about smart cities and all of that. Parallelly, our auto sector, though it is only about 40 years old, our entire auto industry is really 40 years old. But we are on par almost with the global standards. There was a lag always, 5-7 years lag was able to be catching up. In two-wheelers, we are apparently as good or better than Japan in terms of standards, emission standards. Then these things, you know, so last thing is the industry is growing. It's interesting to note the automotive industry is highly tiered. You have the vehicles and a lot of the supply chain industry, very, they are all growing at something like double-digit growth, the component sector. So that's the context we have. It also provides a new kind of job and skilling opportunities. From the BIS situation, we need to be able to define a uniform charging infrastructure which is predictable, which is available, and it looks the same any part of the country you go. And it should work whether it is in Rajasthan or in some monsoon climate. So we need to deal with three things. We need to deal with the charging protocol. There is a communication involved between the... let me just see this. So that's a simple diagram. But basically that's what it is. What is standardized is just this much today. We will get to the network later. So there are three contexts, or four contexts actually. There is two kinds of AC charging possible and two kinds of DC charging. So there is a controller sitting in the car and there is a controller sitting in the charger. So if you happen to devise a new mechanism at the charger end, the vehicle end has to change, which means you are actually doing a new vehicle development. We have to deal with this very carefully. People advise us that we should have an Indian connector. But the Indian connector means the car has to be newly developed for the Indian connector or things like that. It's not a very easy thing to do. And you can do it only once. You can't keep on changing. You set up the standards and it remains there forever almost. You choose a connector, next 25, 30 years you cannot change it. You'll disrupt the market if you do something. So those issues we need to deal with. But basically there are four levels of power to be delivered. When we say AC charging, what we mean is we are giving an AC outlet and the charger is on the vehicle. The vehicle comes with the charger. Now depending on whether the vehicle has got a small unit on board or big, there are two ways are possible. In DC charging, the charger would bypass all of these onboard systems and charger will directly communicate with the battery. So this is smart charging. I think many of you may have these smart chargers with you, you know, which I got a Nokia, which will charge in 1 hour flat. So I have thrown away all my battery banks and all that, no need. But this is a little bit different situation. Here what it happens is that charger becomes special. It's got a lot of circuitry. This is the ETD division, people know about it. So there is a continuous sensing of the battery state of health, state of charge, and a lot of other acronyms they talk about. It is continually assessing the battery, its temperature, basic themes, but it has a semantic thing like, you know, you can call it state of health, state of charge. So because basically battery is two electrodes, some electrolyte in between, and you have to push the ion from one to the other. And after some time, they discharge back here, you know. So you have to push it. There is a lot of other stuff involved. It is not that you put a bigger charger and it will charge faster. It's not going to happen. Because you're like trying to feed a child, the more you push, the more resistant. You might end up the whole day running around, but nothing will go inside. Whereas if you allow it the way it is going, it will charge pretty fast. So fast charging can happen in half an hour. If you just follow what the battery state of at that kind of battery state of affairs, you know, let's say. So when the battery is in a more accepting mood, you give more, otherwise you pull back. So this big charger sitting out there is actually a slave to the battery. This is the DC charging paradigm. I'm not sure very people get it. Even in higher senior level, we talk about, they talk about putting up bigger and bigger chargers. You know, it won't work. It is completely dependent on the communication. So the standard which Matthew and I were doing is so much of communication we talk about, pages and pages of communication, though it is actually passing electricity, you know, which is not really talked about much, except for safety protocol and all that. So three things. So you will see a lot of this. When you say protocol, it is about a lot about communication. The connector, connectors are standardized here, but that we are talking about something more than the three pins. We are talking about the extra pins which will carry communication. There are two kinds of communication. There's analog communication go, which gives a basic hygienic hygiene about safety and things like that, making sure that everything is fine before power can be allowed to flow. And there is digital communication which allows this communication between the battery and the charger, or continuous back and forth communication to enable a faster, smarter charging mechanism. So this diagram which I've shown here is just between the vehicle and the charger. That's about it. It is like it's like a faucet. You know, the plumbing we haven't talked about yet. That is a different thing altogether. We are assuming the plumbing will be there, and we talk about what kind of faucet will work. And there is a lot of debate about it. Each company comes with their own faucet, and it doesn't work sometimes. Japanese have their way, Europeans have a different method, and Chinese have an entirely different way. And the three things hinge on this. One is EV to the charger, EV to EVSC digital communication. They differ among them. The connectors which are used for it. And of course, the charging protocol itself. The number of standards we talk about, this is the introductory stage which we need to do it very quick. We are hoping by January things should be in shape. Our set of standards should be there. But after this, we need to get on to the other things. We have published one of those standards. Matthew, we published which one? Charging protocol, right? Number one we have published, and the second and third we are still working on it. Okay, so this is how some of the connectors look like. This connector is for the AC charging. I have only shown for simplicity the three-phase connectors. There is another simple one. The two types define the standards. So the top one, which is called the type 2, is universally accepted. You can see the number of pins out there. There are only three pins required for providing power. Rest are various kind of communications. And the bottom one is another variant of that. It just, the construction is different, depending on the amount of power that has to flow, the safety features, all of that. Both these things have come from Germany. So you can say type 2. AC charging is type 2, more or less synonymous, because that is the most used. But it could be a different connector as well. Now, standard gets into many details like this. This is one thing. There are pages and pages of these kind of drawings out there. This is just about type 2. Then comes the DC charging. First thing is, two of the pins are very fat. You can notice that. The two pictures on the right, they are the DC chargers. The blue one is the Japanese charger called the CHAdeMO. That was the earliest one. It is by Nissan and the Tokyo Electric Corporation, they did it. The two big fat connectors provide the power, DC power. All the rest are communication. They're all essential. They can communication. The next one is a European version. Again, the two big pins at the bottom provide the power. The three on top provide PLC communications. So that is where the number is less. PLC and the essential analog communication. Actually, the top two on the left side of you here are the same thing. If you look at this, these are basic stuff, that's why I'm dwelling on it. This is the AC connector. Now the AC connector plus two pins below that becomes a combined charger. So we are talking about two different kind of connectors here. One is a Japanese DC only connector, and then a combo of those two. On the vehicle you find that small picture, that is a single outlet on the vehicle, but the one which is plugged in are the two different kinds of plugs. So that's what it is. Now we still haven't come to the meat of it. This is just the overall thing. And okay, so the issue here is, so these are standard connectors which are developed because they were developed to charge vehicles which carry about half a ton of battery. These are the regular vehicles used, whether it is a Nissan Leaf or going all the way up to Tesla, which is carrying the biggest battery of all cars. They all have to be charged, so they have devised this mechanism. If your vehicle is a two-wheeler, this is a little bit of an overkill. You know, this one which you have here looks like the headlight of a two-wheeler, right? So that won't work for us. So this is one issue we are confronted with. When you talk about buses, this is going to burn up. You need a better thing. You need a liquid-cooled thing. So those issues we deal, whereas not in the West, they don't have that problem. More or less, it is a car, when you talk about car of different shapes. So we have many small vehicles. Even our cars are small category. The current electric cars are small ones. They don't fall in the medium category. So in India, we are grappling with this. So Rajivji, that is, we are taking time. We are into uncharted territory in this area. We are saying that the three different definitions required. We are saying that, but we are not doing it. At the moment, we are just going ahead and standardizing for the medium voltage, knowing very well that will not do the job for the entire country's population. In fact, cars are less. 3 million cars sold, 20 million two-wheelers sold. And buses, we are expecting about 2 lakh buses to get sold. They're a very different category. So we will have to address that, but at least some acknowledge standards, global standards we need to bring into the country. That's what our first set of standards are. And the other things I've mentioned, okay. Now, a little bit more getting into it. Why we have to be a little bit different? Why we need to kind of, the issue I'm trying to address here is, there is something standing in the way of we going and standardizing things very fast, because we have local conditions to attend to. One of those conditions is we have a larger percentage of renewables coming in. So this is a variable load. The amount of electricity in the grid is not always very predictable. So it is a problem, because once generated, you can't put it back. You have to use it. And the consumer is not there to use it when you want. Sometimes he or she wants more. So there is going to be variability. There is a need to be able to manage it. So the interesting thing is electric vehicles can help. First of all, electric vehicle is a variable load. You can refuse to charge an electric vehicle when your grid is in a bad shape. Or you can provide a lower tariff and say, please charge at this time of the day when there is surplus electricity and not enough consumers. This is the basic thing. So those things are picturized here. You know, there are different kinds of grid support mechanisms possible. There is also a possibility that you could, when you're not using the battery, you could provide some services to the grid in the sense, allow the grid to take power from your battery and pay more for it, because the grid is going to ask for power when it is in a crisis and they're willing to pay more. So your car can earn money by just sitting in the garage and plugged in, nothing else you have to do. Mm-hmm. It's possible. So these kind of things we can allow to happen, but we need to do something here for that, for the standards. All of that is built in into DC charging situation, because there's a digital communication out there. But DC charging means you are aiming at fast charging. You want to go somewhere, you want to quickly top up and go. And that is an unlikely place where you can manage all this load, because you plug in, charge and leave. So that doesn't seem to be a place where you can do this load management or later on bidirectional charging and things. So when we define, I think for our country, we will have to define digital communication for the AC also. Because a large number of vehicles, eventually millions will be plugged in. Small transactions can happen, or maybe small load management can happen. You can dump more power or throttle it. And conceiving of that, we will have to, from BIS, make a little bit tweak to the global accepted method and say that in our situation, we also need to be able to control the AC charging as well from the grid side. It is there in the standard, latest versions of standard, it is there, but nobody implements, because abroad people charge at the garage. This has never occurred to them, this is an important thing. But for us, we have to, this is part of the local conditions. Then this one is about the back end, a whole lot of things out there. Two different streams, one is a power management, the other is the payment gateway. And these are not very well standardized. There are plenty of standards available, but mostly in the open domain. Anything starting with O is actually the open standard. And they have control over something like 90% of the market today. The choice in connectors as a result of this situation, please don't look at the numbers, they are now outdated, I couldn't correct them. The actual values, there is some disparity. But you see the columns. There are three kinds of vehicles which we need to charge. And it is not figured out because it is not a problem for the Europeans, it is our problem. We have to figure it out. So while doing that, do we create our own connector, which means we are talking about 3-4 years of development work and testing and finalizing. We have to convince our senior bureaucrats that that's not going to work. We have to use something existing and re-use it for our purpose, maybe for some ways. So this is, we are dealing with all of that. So the BIS and DSTS put together a joint working group. DG chairs it, and she's been guiding us strongly. So we have issued a grand challenge to address this issue. So considering all the standards, all the methods of charging, all that remaining we are accepting all of that. But can we do some tuning for this purpose? Now, while doing this tuning, also get an opportunity that you are now designing the entire infrastructure. You're designing for the small vehicle, medium vehicle, and the heavy vehicles. Then can we choose one protocol and say, this is what we'll do in the entire country? Whatever vehicle is there, if we can choose to do it through one protocol. So if you make a choice like that, probably this is a way to low cost things. Per unit cost may not come down. You cannot really reduce the cost of a connector. Even if you make it in India a little bit, it'll be like that. But by removing the redundancies, by removing variability, by saying that everything in India will follow the same method, so the competition will throw up. We don't know what is that method, whether it's the CAN protocol or the power line communication. We are expecting the people to participate in the competition and they'll come up with the designs. So, and obviously a person is designing for the entire infrastructure. They will use just one protocol. So that's our hope. This is a little bit different thing. So now the standards agency is throwing a competition and trying to kind of, it's a very different way of doing standards.